state, and we're putting on the speaker. And Brett has agreed to be one of the members of our student bureau. I love to give this talk because I think it shows a lot of the innocence of Wisconsin and other states from the start of the war. And the war starts rather suddenly, right after the election of Abraham Lincoln in November of 1860. Lincoln was the sectional candidate, elected by a minority of the popular vote. And 4 days after the results of the election are known, South Carolina calls for a secession convention. Secession is a word meaning that they're trying to separate from the Union. They meet in South Carolina, and on Thursday, December 30th, 1860, they vote to secede from the Union. The vote was 169-0. So they were very much active. Mississippi left January 9th, Florida, Alabama, Georgia, Louisiana, and Texas. The delegation of seceded states met in Montgomery, Alabama, and there created a Confederate States of America, and news of that happening was carried through the South on wild, wild yells that would be heard on 100 battlefields. In Wisconsin, new Republican governor, Alexander, he's making all these disparaging remarks about Walworth County. I'm from Walworth County. old man Potter is buried in our cemetery. These rock climbing people are, this Jerry Ray, what is this?
I apologize for Walworth County.
We were loyal to Walworth County. I'm sorry. I can't resist that. I've been sitting there steaming about his remarks this whole talk. Anyway, in Wisconsin, with the news of the election of the Confederacy, Governor Alexander Randall of Waukesha, who is the new Republican governor, issued a warning. He said this: secession is revolution. Revolution is war. War against the government of the United States is treason. Wisconsin is true. Her people steadfast. She will not destroy the Union, nor consent that it shall be done. And then he set about preparing for war. His words, of course, were lost in the clamor of the moment, and not heard much out of the state lines. Then in April of made up of all totally of militia companies. It was signed on for 90 days. And what we don't understand is, you know, how do you put together a thousand uniforms in the space of a couple of weeks? There were 40 different manufacturers of uniforms for the first Wisconsin, and they were gray uniforms because the militia color of the time was based on the English tradition, which was gray. So they scrambled around the state trying to find enough gray cloth to create 1,000 uniforms. Now, some of the militia companies had coats, but most of them didn't. In fact, the first Wisconsin Kepi, I don't show you a Kepi, somebody stick there, show me a flat hat. Did you have
one? No, forage cap.
Yeah, forage cap. Actually, that's, you know, they're very flat cap. The first Wisconsin cap was made by one of the wives of the officers and then passed around so everybody could sew them. So you can imagine the quality varies in this regiment we didn't get. They have no belts, they have no shoes, they have no tin cups, they have no shovels, they have nothing. And Governor Randall and his aides have to scramble through the state creating these uniforms. A large number of uniforms, almost 100, were made at the state prison in Waltona. The commandant of the prison was a man named Hans Hay. And Hans Hay offered, he said he had 20 tailors who were inmates at the prison. And he offered them and three sewing machines that he had. Okay, I know, authentic types. Three sewing machines to do these uniforms. There's only two of those uniforms that I know of still in existence, one in Madison and one in Milwaukee from the first Wisconsin. I'm convinced that all of these great uniforms from Wisconsin are Richard Federer. All three of the same. They don't have a clue what they have. The first Wisconsin was raised at Camp Scott, which was named after Winfield Scott. It was in the Milwaukee area, and they were raised there. So the Wisconsin Suffers was first casualties were one of the boys from the first Wisconsin drowns in the river while swimming. He apparently broke into a shallow spot and banged his head. Anyway, they get shipped off in late May to go to the front. They get sent to Washington with a little band out in Harper's Ferry and fight in the Battle of Falling Waters very early in the war. So Governor Randall this time is frantic to raise other regiments, but he doesn't have a lot of rough stock because the militia system is so polluted. Now there was some militia operations in the state. As I said, the militia companies of the day tended to sort out along ethnic lines because the Irish and the Germans tended to like these little organizations, but they were like clubs, as I said. And a lot of the Europeans had military experience and liked that, so they proceeded to form. There was the Black Jaegers, and they were the Irish Montgomery Guard and the Irish Union Guard. And they paraded an army against squabble most of the time they played. Now, it gets to be, what happened was in 1851, an anti-Catholic speaker came into Milwaukee, and a riot ensued, so they called out two militia companies, one Irish and one German. When they reached the scene, they began fighting with each other. So the Yankees, right, these New England Protestant types, decided to form their own company called the Milwaukee Light Guard, which is one of the premier companies of the Midwest at the time of the Civil War. They were so famous that they went to Chicago for a week and spent a week partying in bivouac with their Chicago friends, ran up a bill of $500 for cigars and whiskey. And when they got back, I trust you guys are not running up any bills on the local. So we had all these petty jealousies, and the Milwaukee Light Guard is like Company A of the First Wisconsin. It was a big company, goes into the war, very prominent. Rufus King was a I may not be successful. I may be banned and limited in office. So they have a high level, an 8-foot wooden plank floor fence. They remodeled a large one of the buildings of, inside as a mess hall that would cost 37 cents a day to feed a soldier. When the first volunteers arrived, they found the buildings still leaked and were drafty. One soldier wrote home, "Swimming out of the bumps, be careful if it rains or not, for we are used to it." The buildings were used as livestock buildings during the state fair. And he said every night when they put they called the lights out and the period came, he said the inhabitants of the old barns took the honking, quacking, and mooing in the dark to mimic the animals once cows there. So he didn't sleep when they were hanging the thing. So they get on the trains, here at Friend of Rome. Most of the people were sad to see the young boys, relatives, family members get on and go off to war, and they thought they never we'd never see him again. But many of the citizens of Madison were happy to see the Secretary constantly get on the trains and go. There had been 7 cruel abuses and annoyances on the part of soldiers involved in civilians. One recruit from Minnesota, who was in the Fox Lake Company, I think, wrote a long letter complaining about the rough, vulgar blackguards in his company. He denounced Madison as miserably dull, with no life, no gaiety, and scarcely amusement, and hardly a pretty woman here. No wonder, I bet he comes over easy. So they quickly discovered that there was a loose board on the fence, and you could run into Madison and go through that loose board and run to Madison for a frolic. Brewery. They demanded that Mr. White open up the brewery long after slow to get to the tables, found there wasn't. There was some grumbling about that. Not a lot, because it was early in the war and they were pretty innocent. So they get back on the trains and they go to Chicago. They're escorted through the city at night by local militia units, admiring crowds, cheers, hollering. Chicago Times reports, the regiment is composed of the most soldier-looking fighting material of any that we have ever seen. That's still true today, don't you think? They get to Toledo, another fine breakfast. Pretty girls pass out donuts and pails of water. Trip across Ohio is one ovation after another. They're welcomed at Cleveland, where wholesome little girls dressed in white with blue and red ribbons in their hair came through the people and shook hands with the men and over and over again wished them goodbye and a safe return. Almost every stop the rubber was provided. And one soldier grumbled that it was greatly needed. We miss our Wisconsin rubber very much. The impact did not have any water that is any good as we got on the old Badger State. That's in Ohio. So they get this Cleveland, and an officer is asleep in the car and wakes up and finds the car completely empty. He looks out the window and he writes this. He says, I saw about 200 ladies on the platform and about 50 of our regiment actively engaged in kissing them in such a businesslike way that at first I thought the regiment had gotten into an active service. James will probably go, God bless the state of Ohio. Old men and young men, her women and her fair damsels who fed us and cheered us all the way. They get to Pittsburgh. They don't like Pittsburgh much. We call it a dingy, dirty, business-like town. The air was thick to travel, and the cars went through a backwards industrial area. One officer wrote, he buckshot each, and we are mighty nervous feeling about the four days. It's so hard by this. So they marched through the town. Two shots of fireworks and rocks were thrown at them, but the officers and the police keep everybody pretty closed up. And they have no trouble. They're back on the train, half all the way on the train derails between Baltimore and Washington. There's another 3 hour delay. And finally they reach Washington. And at daybreak on June 25th, they're a long journey, left everybody thirsty, hungry, and dirty, and ready for a fight. They reach Washington. They march to Woodward Block on Pennsylvania Avenue. And then to 7th Street, where they'll stay a week. A New York Tribune reported, well, the soldiers, mostly hard-fisted lumbermen from the primaries of Nevada State, they say they will fight if ordered, and if not ordered, will fight anyway. And they will. So they think, of course, that, you know, that the first Western regiment to reach the state, one of the first three regiments to reach the state, and they think that the eyes of the West are upon, and the eyes of the East are looking at these boys in the frontier. They have all sorts of trouble because many of the regiments around them from Massachusetts and New Jersey and else in New York thought that these frontier boys were either half Indians or still savages living with the tribes. And there's all sorts of stories that they tell, like when they approached one soldier and a farmer said, "You guys shoot very well," and he said, "Yeah, we can hit a squirrel at 1,000 yards. The farmer said, "Oh, that's pretty good shooting." They said, "Well, if you can't even shy, you can stay here." They walked into a field. They said, the New Jersey guy said, "He said, you guys must like sleeping out in the open. That's what you do up at home all the time anyway, right?" And of course, this guy that they're talking to was from Pennsylvania. And he said, "Oh, yeah, we sleep outside." He said, we don't like the tents. He said, "But we kind of use them because we can hang our scalps on them." Thank you.
and units get blue uniforms?
You're getting into a really serious question. What happened was, contrary to common opinion, it wasn't John Gibbon who wore the uniforms, but actually by Samuel Cutler. As the gray uniforms wore out, they had to seek replacements. So they replaced them by companies. In other words, all of a sudden, the company of the second Wisconsin, the women were gray and ass second. One soldier said, watching the second Wisconsin on parade is like watching the regiment of Highlanders minus their kilts. There was such a large hole in their trousers. He said that the gentlest of breezes could caress their Adonis-like forms. So they needed new trousers. That starts in November, October of 1861 when they're in Washington. You begin to see the transition, and as it's by companies, and not like the one guy said in Donald pronounced, they're going to wear black hats and whatever. So there's actually photographs of seventh Wisconsin guys in frock coats, blue frock coats, and gray state caps. So there's this period of time. They didn't really like to get rid of the Wisconsin ones. They thought they were better quality for a while. So by May of 1862, when Gibbon takes command, he likes the way they look in their black hats and frock coats. He orders that for all of the regiments, and they have to buy a lot of this equipment out of their clothing allowance, which was not a half a day for them. And then the leggings and the white gloves. could all go to Canada or Texas or somewhere. Somewhere
else. Is there a substitute list available?
You can read it in the red. You can read it in the red, but it must go.
The trouble with the Native Americans is that they listed under the white guy's name. And when you try to find it, it's like, you can't find it on tribal rolls and the Native ones to connect. My wife's a little, she has a little gibberish. She's not really a half blogger, but she's pretty white. But she had three uncles in the 36 or something.
Yeah.
And they were French Canadians. they enlisted just because they had nothing to do. You know, you're 20 years old, you can't go to your family's
home.
They were starving on the reservation. And they said,
there's a warrior tradition.
My distinct privilege to introduce to you the President of the United States, Abraham Lincoln. Douglas, so my remarks will be very short. As you know, our country at this time is in a very troubled condition. You have heard, I'm certain, that a federal fort, Fort Sumter, has been fired upon in the harbor of Charleston, South Carolina. I hate to say it, but I'm afraid that this storm has been coming for a very long time. The central focus of this conflict is not new. The institution of slavery and the right, as the Southern states perceive it, to extend slavery into the territory has been at the heart of more than one of our crises since this union was first established in 1787. However, the conflict seems to now have accelerated to the recent election. In the months leading up to the election last November, many of the Southern states began to threaten, if Lincoln is elected, we shall secede from the Union. I was, they did. And the beginning of those with the great state of South Carolina has in fact already voted for secession. Let me say here and now, I do not believe that our founding fathers erected a system of government with built-in mechanisms for self-destruction. I believe this day is intended for this union to be perpetual, and I intend to defend that perpetuity. Even though before I got to Washington to take the oath of office, rebels beginning to attack and confiscate our federal property, including the revenue cutter of the Star of the West, Fort Pickens in Florida. And unfortunately, President Buchanan did not put his foot down to take action against this. Our demand that the rebels cease and desist their illegal activities. I believe this may have in fact emboldened some of them to push even further. Almost immediately after being inaugurated, I received word from Major Anderson at Fort Sumter that he was cut off from Charleston, running short of supplies, and was not sure how much longer he could hold out. I then consulted General Winfield Scott, who advised me that he felt that the fort could not be held and that surrender might be inevitable. The decision was finally made to send an expedition to resupply the fort with provisions only. No additional troops, no munitions, no armaments. And through appropriate channels, I then notified Governor Pickens of South Carolina that, that supply ships were coming to the aid of the starving men and they would not be fired upon. No hostilities need occur. Major Anderson had already notified the authorities in Charleston that if he did not receive provisions very soon, he would have to surrender the fort anyway, probably in about 2 days. I do not know to this day why the rebels did not wait for the ships to arrive or even for Major Anderson to peacefully surrender. And as you know, of course, artillery batteries began firing on the fort on the morning of April the 12th. I had hoped for a peaceful resolution to this situation, and we could compromise our way out of it, as we've done many times in the past. But my fellow citizens, I have taken a sacred oath to preserve, protect, and defend this Union and this Constitution against all enemies, against all attacks. Any attacks, and I do not care if they come from Europe or South Carolina, I will not allow a federal installation to be attacked with impunity, no matter from where the attack comes or what their cause. I am so issuing a call for volunteers and militia to put down this insurrection. Ladies and gentlemen, let us have right that the faith that right makes right, and in that faith, let us continue to do our duty as we see it. Our nation is in great jeopardy at the present. I call upon you to assist me in the great efforts that may need to be made in order to preserve this great union. And I thank you for your faithfulness and service. And may God bless you and may he continue to bless this great nation that he has never forgotten. Thank you.
Thank you.